Hello students, this is Pat Thakkar. From our today's lecture, we are going to start our new chapter, which is convection. In our previous videos, we have completed our chapter number 5 from the syllabus, which is two-phase heat transfer, boiling and condensation. Now, in convection, which is different from the conduction and radiation, because in conduction chapter, to find out conduction heat transfer rate, we use equation which is given by Fourier, which is K dT by dx. In that equation, K is the conductivity of material, which can be easily calculated. A is the cross-sectional area. dT is the temperature difference between the two layers from where conduction takes place. And dx is the thickness of the system. Similarly, to calculate the radiation heat transfer rate, we use Stefan-Boltzmann equation, in which sigma is a Stefan-Boltzmann constant whose value is 5.67 into 10 to minus 8, and based on the temperature of the system we can easily calculate the amount of electromagnetic wave which is going to be emitted by the system. But to calculate heat transfer rate by convection mode, we generally use equation which is given by Newton, which is HA delta T. In that equation, H is a convective heat transfer rate, convective heat transfer coefficient. A is the surface area of the system, and delta T is a temperature difference, temperature of surface minus temperature of the surrounding. But in this equation, value of H, value of convective heat transfer coefficient, depends on various parameters. It basically mainly depends on the fluid properties, because in convection there is a solid boundary with fluid in motion. So, it mainly depends on fluid properties like velocity of the fluid, density of the fluid, viscosity of the fluid, specific heat of the fluid, as well as it also depends on the surface geometry as well as surface properties of the solid. So, the value of H is difficult to calculate. That's why find out convection heat transfer rate is difficult as compared to conduction rate and the radiation rate. So to understand convection heat transfer properly, first we need to understand some basics of the fluid mechanics. So in this video, first we understand the basic principle, how convection through heat transfer takes place between the solid and the fluid. Then we revise some basics of the fluid mechanics. So let's start with the first slide.
As we have already studied in heat transfer introduction, that in heat transfer there are three modes of heat transfer: conduction, convection and radiation. From that three mode of heat transfer, conduction and convection are common because in both conduction and convection the presence of material or medium is necessary. Now convection is nothing but it is a conduction with a fluid in motion. So in convection, we require presence of fluid motion. One solid boundary with a fluid in motion, then the heat transfer will occur by the convection mode. Now, we know that whenever there is a heat transfer through the solid, it is always done by the conduction mode, because in a solid, molecules remains at relatively fixed position. Whenever there is a heat transfer through liquid or gas, it can be by conduction or convection. It depends on the presence of bulk fluid motion. If there is a motion of bulk fluid, then it will be convection. But if there is no motion of fluid at the solid boundary, then heat will transfer by conduction mode. Let's understand by example. Here, in this first figure, we can see that there is a one block whose temperature, one surface, whose temperature is 50 degrees Celsius, which is higher than the surrounding temperature, because surrounding temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. So heat transfer must take place between this system and the surrounding. Now here you can see we have provided one fan which is continuously generating air, continuously making force on the air to flow over this surface. Now when the surrounding air whose temperature is nearly about 20 degrees flowing over this surface whose temperature is 50 degrees Celsius, there must be a heat transfer between this surface and the surrounding air. Now here the air is continuously flowing, so the layer which get heat from this surface is going to take heat the temperature of that layer will become somewhat higher than the 20 degrees Celsius, and then that layer will be replaced by another layer which is continuously flowing from this fan. Done. So this is known as the forced convection, in which you make external arrangement for the flowing of the fluid, then the convection is known as the forced convection. Now, if we remove the fan, then whatever the heat transfer takes place by the convection will be the free convection, or we can say that the natural convection. The only motion of the air layer is due to the buoyancy effect, or we can say that due to the density difference, because the first layer which comes into the contact with the surface whose temperature is above the environment, the layer will get heat from that surface, the temperature of that layer will rise. Now, as the temperature of that layer becomes higher than the other layers, the density of that layer will be reduced as compared to the other layer, so that the lower density layer will rise up and replaced by the higher dense layer. So this is known as the convection current, as we have already seen in our previous videos. So the only motion responsible for the layer is due to the density difference. This is known as the convection currents. So this type of convection is known as the free convection. Now, at last, in this figure, you can see that there is no motion of the air. Here, the layer of the air is in contact with this surface, and there is no motion of the air, then the heat will transfer only by the conduction mode. There is no convection current. So when there is no motion of any fluid, then heat will transfer by the conduction mode. And when there is a motion of the fluid, it will be by convection. Done. Now here, from this two figure, we can say that when the velocity of air is higher, or we can say that the convection heat transfer rate is higher in a forced convection as compared to free convection, because velocity of fluid plays an important role. Similarly, experiment shows that convection heat transfer strongly depends on the fluid properties. Fluid properties like dynamic viscosity, thermal conductivity, its density, specific heat, and fluid velocity. These are the parameters on which convective heat transfer rate strongly depends. There are some also, it also depends on the geometry and the surface roughness of the solid. Okay. So, despite the complexity of convection, because in conduction we know that we can find out conduction heat transfer rate by using simple Fourier equation, which is minus k dT by dx. In a radiation, by using Stefan Boltzmann constant, we can easily find out the electromagnetic wave or amount of energy which is going to be emitted by the any surface at particular temperature. But convection is a little bit complex as compared to the conduction and radiation, because convection heat transfer rate is depends on various parameters, as we have already seen in our previous slide. It mainly depends on different fluid properties. Despite this complexity of convection, the rate of convection heat transfer is observed to be proportional to the temperature difference, which is given by the Newton's, and it is known as the conveniently expressed by Newton's law of cooling, which is Q convection is equal to H A delta T. Here H is a convective heat transfer constant, A S is a surface area from which the heat transfer takes place, T S is the surface temperature, and T infinite is the surrounding temperature. In this equation, H is the convective heat transfer coefficient. The value of H is depends on the different parameter which we have already discussed. That's why to find out convection of heat transfer rate is more complex as compared to conduction rate and the radiation rate. So you should not be deceived by the simple appearance of this relation, because the convective heat transfer coefficient H depends on the several of the mentioned variables, and thus it is difficult to determine. Now, convective heat transfer coefficient mainly depends on the so many parameters related to fluid. So we have to revise our fluid mechanics concept, which is the science that deals with the behavior of the fluids at the rest or in a motions. So first we need to brush up our basics of the fluid mechanics to understand how convection heat transfer rate can be find out. So first we know about the viscosity, which is the property of the fluid which determine the resistance to the which determine its resistance to the shear stress, or we can say that it is a resistance offered by the fluid to flow. It is a measurement of internal fluid motion which causes the resistance to flow, and it is due to the cohesion and the molecular momentum exchange between the fluid layers. Whenever there is a motion of any fluid, it is done by the layer by layer, and the layer which is in contact with the solid, the velocity of that layer will be reduced, and that layer produces shear stress on the just adjacent layer which is above it, and that's how, due to the cohesion and the molecular momentum, the resistance to flow occurs, which is generally known as the viscosity. Now for the ideal fluid there is no viscosity, but no fluid can be classified as the perfectly ideal fluid, but fluid which is with very little viscosity are sometimes considered as the ideal fluid for the simplicity of the calculations. Now let's understand viscosity in some detail. Here in figure you can see that there is a something solid boundary on which a flow of fluid is occur, which is layer by layer. The layer which is in contact with the solid have some amount of velocity. Suppose the velocity of this layer is u. So the velocity of just adjacent above layer is u plus du, as shown in figure. The distance between these two layer is dy, and the distance of this first layer from the solid boundary is y. So from the calculation, from the observation, there is a shear stress which is produced by the lower layer to the adjacent upper layer, which resists the motion of the upper layer. Similarly, upper layer try to pull out the lower layer, so there is a shear stress between these two layer, and it is directly proportional to the change in velocity with respect to y. So tau, which is a shear stress which is produced between these two layer, is directly proportional to the change in velocity with respect to y. So it is directly proportional to du by dy. Now removing proportionality and putting proportionality constant, which is mu. So this mu is known as the coefficient of dynamic viscosity. Clear? And this du by dy is a velocity gradient. Now let's learn about mu is a dynamic viscosity. Now what is kinematic viscosity? It is just a ratio between the dynamic viscosity with the fluid density. It is generally denoted by nu. This is mu, which is dynamic viscosity. This is nu, which is mu by rho, ratio of dynamic viscosity with fluid density. Now let's understand classification of fluid flows, which we have already learned in our fluid mechanics subjects. Let's just revise. There are wide variety of fluid flow problems encountered in practice, and it is usually convenient to classify them on the basis of some common characteristic to make it feasible to study them in a group. So let's classify fluids. First is a viscous flow and inviscid flow. We know that the fluid which have higher viscosity, it is generally considered, the flow of that fluid is generally considered as the viscous flow. There is no fluid which have zero viscosity, but the fluid which have very little viscosity considered to be the inviscid flow. Second is internal flow and external flow. From the figure we can see that if the flow of a fluid is from this internal pipe, internal side of the system, like there is a flow of air from this pipe, so it is an internal flow. But there is suppose there is a flow of air from the surface, from the external part of the pipe, then it is known as the external flow. Like in this figure you can see that water is flowing from this pipe, so it is considered to be the internal flow, and flow of air is from above surface of this pipe, so it is known as the external flow. And then compressible flow and incompressible flow, it is depend on the density of the flow. As if density variation of the fluid, it is depend on the density variation of the fluid during the flow. If density, generally density of the liquid are constant, and thus flow of liquid is typically incompressible. On the other hand, gases are highly compressible, so it is considered to be the compressible flow. Next is a laminar flow and turbulent flow. We already know it depends on the streamline. If there is a smooth streamline which is constant, then it is known as the laminar flow. And if there are highly disordered fluid motion, that is typically occurs at the high velocity, which is characterized by the velocity fluctuation, then it would be a turbulent flow. Laminar flow generally occur for the flow of high viscosity fluid, such as oil, at a low velocity. And the flow of low viscosity fluid, such as air, at high velocity generate turbulent flow. Now, natural flow and forced flow, as we have already seen in our previous slide, in which some external arrangement like pump and fan are provided, then the flow of fluid is known as the forced flow. If the fluid motion is due to the natural means, such as buoyancy effect, the layer which get the heat is naturally due to the density difference replaced by the another high dense layer, then it will be the natural flow. Then steady flow and unsteady flow. If the property of the fluid does not change with the time, then it is a steady flow. If the property of the fluid at a different location change with respect to time, then it is known as the unsteady flow. So, this is the introduction of convection chapter. So, that's it for today. Thank you so much.